Hello, my dear students. Welcome all of you with this new session and with a new chapter that we are going to start with a new hope that you are getting well with all our lectures. As you are here with the BPSC 133, this course code with the International Comparative Government and Politics, as we are giving you lectures with all of your related to your syllabus. So please get in touch with us and we will be happy with you with all of the sessions. So myself, Dr. Lata Sharma, I will be here with you. I also have remained with you with many of the lectures as I have given related to competitive government and politics. So please stay in touch and we will be happy with you. So we are starting a new topic, that is related with the BPSC 133, that is states, nation and globalization. So this is a new topic and I think you are aware about all of the, we have given the globalization topic also. You can take some idea from that previous lecture that we have given to you. But with this this is connected with the state, nation and globalization. This is connected, that is what is state and what is nation accordingly to the globalization, and what is the role of globalization in state and nation. So we are starting now with this new hope, state, nation and globalization. As usually we are going to start that what is states here, what is the meaning of state and what is the role of state here. Please state, you have to cover up with the state is a political community that has sovereign jurisdiction. As because of we have to cover with this topic with the state, that what is the meaning of state, what is use of a state, and what is the main functioning and qualities of state in a competitive government and politics. So this is that state's roles is very important for making a nation. And as usual, we are going to cover up here that globalization has affected something, the power and qualities and the importance of states, and they have given some progressive, otherwise developed outlook for the states. So state is a political community that has sovereign jurisdiction. My dear students, this is here that state is a political community, because we can say that if we say that who has come first, state, otherwise community, otherwise we can say that who has come is a law can be. So all these things has covered in this state, that state is a political community that has sovereign jurisdiction over a clearly defined territory and exercises. This is that state is a political community. It has a political community. It has make the rules according to the rules and regulation that has sovereign jurisdiction. That is meaning that sovereign jurisdiction there is most and important over a clearly defined territory. What is the defined territory here? That this is the area and this is related to, and this is the border area. This area is related to this state. So there is a clearly defined territory and exercises authority through several institutions, including the government. Yes, who will be the authorized organization, otherwise authorized bodies that will overall sovereign on of the institutions and as well as the government also. That is all of these is covered in the state. So state is a political community that has sovereign jurisdiction. There is a must to be noticed here that there is a sovereign that has a jurisdiction over a clear defined territory. This is that defined territory is here and exercises authority through several institutions, including the government. Several institutions, and there is sovereign jurisdiction upon the government and several institutions, and there is a properly authorized body that defined the territory. Okay, that is called to be state. That is five features of the state is here. That is, it is a sovereign. must is there, that features of the state we are going to cover here, it is a sovereign. That it means state will remain a sovereign. Who is sovereign? An authority. That is sovereign jurisdiction who have. Its institutions are public. Yes, this is through here that the state has the institutions that are public. That is several institution and several organization and territorial organization, and there is a sovereign. It is an instrument of domination. Yes, by this is the way that we kept the domination all upon the organization, upon the institution, upon the public and the population, and all of the governmental bodies, all of the bodies that comes in the jurisdiction of state. So this is an instrument. This is an instrument of domination. Yes, it is a territorial association. Really, this is that all of the association that are connected with the territory, that territory, and they also have a sovereign, and they, due to that, they have an association, territorial association, and all association are well connected with each other. So there is an interdependency of territorial association. This is the way that states has an territorial association, instrument of this is the instrument of domination, and the institutions are public. There is that all the institutions that is to be covered, that is to be sovereign, that has to be sovereign jurisdiction, and it is a sovereign. This is the main features, we can say. This is the state. State is a political community that has sovereign jurisdiction over a clearly defined territory and exercises authority through several institutions, including the government. So, my dear students, as you have got the idea that this is a state and this five features of the state, there is a five features of the state. It is to be in a short manner, we can understand that five features of state, that is, it is a sovereign, its institution as public. This is the way of instrument, we can say. This is the instrument of nomination also, and all of the territorial association are well connected with each other. So this is a state. Now we have covered this state. Four elements of a state. What is the four elements of a state, that which should be more and major element can be counted for making a state? That is, first is there should be a sovereignty of a state. If a state is not sovereign, that it means it is working under any power. So state has a full defined sovereign power. Second element we can say, that is government. All of the state has a fully governmental aspect, governmental capacity, governmental elements. So state, without the government, state cannot be imagined. So government play a role in form of, in the making of a state. This is the thing, that government has a sovereign. In this case, the state is all around connected to sovereignty, and that is the government. Third is there, that territory. State needs a territory, that border areas, that this is the area is well for this state, as like we can say this area, the area of Punjab state, the area of Uttar Pradesh state, that is territory. The territory is fully defined and fully given in the globe, that this territory should be covered for particular this state. So this is the way that all of the jurisdiction, all of the sovereignty, all of the government can work easily, that this territory, otherwise region, otherwise zone, can be treated as a state. Foremost, that is the most important thing, people. Who is the people? That is the people that that we can say population, that we can say the people, that we can say the density of the people. And this is the thing that four elements of the state is sovereignty, government, territory and people. So this is the four elements. First we have given that is sovereignty. Students, you have to understand that this is the very easy thing that we are going to cover here. That is four elements. We can, if we say somebody that what are the elements of the state, you can say easily four elements of the state, that is sovereignty, government, territory and people. So this is the thing that state is totally connected, and state has a particular combined workings of all these. So these are the elements of state. Now we are going to explain here that what the four elements of a state. First is sovereignty, second is government, third is territory and the people. So for your convenience and for your benefit, I have given all of the explanation, because everything should be covered with all of your beginnings, that in future you will not be in a condition that what will happen if you have no explanation about the sovereignty. What is the meaning of sovereignty? What is the government? And in the concern of the state, and what is the territory and what is the people role of in the state. So I have given this in a short explanation. That is sovereignty. Refers to both jurisdiction, the ability of a state to exercise its authority over its territory and people. Yes, it refers here, simple is there. Sovereignty means jurisdiction. It means the ability of a state to exercise its authority over its territory and people. The area that have the state and the people that are living in the state are have the jurisdiction area in a state. So and independence, the freedom for external control. So these are the thing that refers to both jurisdiction. What state do they have? That they have the authority, they have the exercise of authority over its territory and its people. This is the sovereignty. Second is government, is the machinery of the state through which the people will is formulated and carried out. Is a machinery. The government is the machinery by which they are going to sovereign, by which they are going to jurisdictions in the area of the state through which the people will is formulated and carried out. Yes, the government, all of the activities that is related to the people, that is related to people's will. The government is decided by the people's will, and they formulate it and they carried out the government also. So this is a machinery. This is state has a very particular elements of government also. Territory includes all the land, sea and space, and the state exercises jurisdiction on. There is territory includes all the land, sea and airspace, the state exercise jurisdiction on. What happens here, that which is the particular area that state has, and in that area how much land, how much sea area, how much airspace, on that of area the state have a jurisdiction upon that. So state and the government, by the government, and a government by the sovereignty makes a jurisdiction upon all of the airspace, upon the sea and upon the land. So this is the third element, that is territory. That is land, sea and airspace the state exercises jurisdiction on. Next is the people. The people is the organization of human beings living together as a community. Here, without the people, that territory, the land, sea and airspace have no value. And without the government, And if the people are not there, that the government cannot be formulated and cannot be carried out. And when one thing is there, that if the people are not there, upon which the sovereign, the jurisdiction area, the jurisdiction will be done. So there is a foremost and major important works of people, that the organization of human beings living together as a community. There is a need of that, that the people is just like an organization and human beings living together as a community. This is the thing, that four elements of a state, that is, first is sovereignty, government, territory, and people. There is states, types of state. That is, there any type of states? State has something varied aspect, otherwise not. So this is the good answer there, that the state has a varied aspect, that is, state can be effective, state can be weak, and state can also fail also. So effectiveness of a state and the weakness of a state, and if the state cannot work easily, that is, the state can fail. So all of these can be counted as in types of state. That first is effectiveness, second is weak, and third is failed. So these are the types of state. We have also included the explanation here, that how can a state can be effective, that how can you can say that state is doing good, and we can give the comment that is effective, otherwise satisfactory or not satisfactory. So there is that the state controls and taxes the entire territory. Laws are mostly obeyed. The state provides general welfare and security. There exist only minor corruption. This is the thing that we can say the state is working as in a effective role. How we can say that? What the state do? That state controls all of the taxes and upon entire territory. And laws are mostly obeyed. If there are in a state, laws are totally obeyed, mostly we can say obeyed, and the territory is in a peaceful working, the state provides general welfare and safety. And one thing is there, that according to Aristotle and all of the thinkers, what they say, and the J.S. Mill also, that general welfare and security, there is a first and foremost aspect of making a effective state. For making an effective state, that gives, that think about the welfare and security of the people of the state. So there exists only minor corruption. There is one thing or one thing to be counted here, that there should remain minor corruption. What is the meaning of minor corruption? That means the people of the state mostly obey the laws, and they make the state have a proper controlling body upon the person of the state, upon the people of the state, and the entire territory give the taxes. This is the main thing, that laws should be obeyed by the state. And the minor corruption, what is the meaning of minor corruption? That nobody is engaged in making any corruption, any bad things, any bad works, that is to should be counted as that state is not working in an effective way. So these are the things that makes a state that are doing effectively. We can say again that what happened if a state is not working well. This is thing that state can be counted in a weak aspect, in a weak system. That means what should be counted and what should be happening there in a state. That first thing, crime has been penetrated politics. Yes, politics, that is the main phenomena of the state that is to be formulated and run by the government. That is, the crime has been working easily. Criminals are also working easily in the political aspect. Government is weak in fighting lawlessness. What is that? Government is not covering all of the lawlessness society, and they are not capable to control all of the struggles, fighting, and all of the movement that is disturbing to the politics and disturbing to the government also. And they are weak in the corruption and poverty. They are not giving the proper helping aspect to the people of the state that they can fight against the corruption and the poverty. So these are the things, that crime and criminals have penetrated the politics, and lawlessness society and corruption and poverty is going on. Justice is bought and elections are often rigged. Yes, that what is happening, if they all things will be working easily in a state, what will happen again? That justice will be bought and elections are often rigged. Yes, governmental revenues go to the private pockets. Yes, the revenues that has been collected by the taxes and by all other means is that is not collected by the government, and they have been collected in a private pocket. So these are the things that government automatically the state will not work easily, because all of the things is not for the betterment of the state. So crime and criminals, lawlessness society, corruption and poverty, justice is not given the in a fair means, elections are also not covering all of the rules, regulations, and governmental revenues is not collected by the government and properly by the authorized bodies that has been to be collected. So this is the thing, that the state is counted as a weak state. Here is one thing, that what happened if a state is not working well? This is the scene created to be here, that state will fail. No national government exists. The state is ruled by warlords, private army and militants. Gun is the law, education and health standard decline. There is, if any no national government exists, we can say there is no government is in a state, and state is ruled by warlords, private army and militants, as happens in most of the countries. And gun is the law education. Gun means there is a warfare, there is a system that should be corrupted, and health standard decline. If all these things will not be covered, that health standard will also decline, because the militants and army and private army and warlords will not take care, they will not give the welfare society welfare, they will not give attention to the for the welfare society, and they will not give properly attention to the humans and the people of the state. So no national government, if there is the, if happens just like that, the state is ruled by, what will happen? The state is ruled by warlords, army, private army and militants. So this is the health standards decline also, as we have told to you. This is the thing, that the state will be counted in a failed situation. Government, is the machinery of the state through which the will of the people is formulated and carried out. What happens? That if the is the machinery of the state through which the will of the people is formulated and carried out. Aristotle, six types of government. There is a meaning that government, according to Aristotle, there is a six types of government. He has told that who governs, how many governs. If there is a one governs, there is a who governs if there is a one person, who governs if there is a few person, if who governs if there is a many persons. There is one, if a person of the state governs only one person, that is monarchy. If the few person have a domination, that means aristocracy. And one thing is there, if the many persons are dominating the state, that should be counted in a polity, and we can say also the democratic system. There is that Aristotle has given the six types of government, that is one, few, many, and monarchy, aristocracy, and polity. Negative forms, we have given there the positive forms. And there is tyranny, oligarchy, and democracy. There is that states has a negative form also, that is tyranny, we can say oligarchy, and democracy. This is the democracy we are also counting here, that is tyranny also counted here, and oligarchy also. As we have given the topic with the connect with the globalization, that is meaning that globalization and nation state importance, what is the role, what is the utility, and what is the main functioning of globalization including the nation state. If there is any scene has been covered that nation state has been changed due to the globalization, otherwise that is covering all of the aspect that is to be covered by the globalization. Globalization has any effect upon the nation state or not? So these are the questions that should be covered in this, that nation state and the globalization is the process through which societies have become so intertwined or interconnected that events and decisions in one part of the world have significant effects on the lives of the people in the part of the world. Now we are saying that is there any effect upon the globalization, by the globalization, on the nation state? Yes. Is the process that through which societies have become so intertwined or interconnected? This is the way that all of the societies, we can say state also, societies also, they have become interconnected, that events and decisions in one part of the world have significant effects on the lives of the people in the part of the world. Yes, that any event, any decisions, any type of the working that has been happened in any corner of the world have a significant effects on the lives of the people. Every person is in a many forms is to be affected. As usual, he can remain anywhere. So by the globalization, the societies and the people lives has been affected more and more. So we can say that events and decisions in one part of the world have significant effects on the lives of people in the part of the world. Characteristics of globalization. This is that globalization has any type of characteristics, qualities, features that can be covered here. in concern with nation state, that is declining relevance of geographical distances. Yes, there is a geographical distances has declining relevance. There is a way that there is a relevance of declining distances. Otherwise, declining geographical distance has a relevance in that case of globalization, because it has become the comfort, it has given the comfort to the people of the world. Lessening significance of territorial boundaries. Yes, as usual, that we, if we count, if we think about that, before 91, what there is a geographical, the geographical distance has a value, but after that, the declining relevance has make the effect upon the geographical distance, and there is a territorial boundaries has less significance, has given the less importance. Deepening and broadening of political processes such that the local national, this is that political processes has become more wide. How? Because there is a way that has been given by the globalization, we can say, by the universalization, we can say, that is the technology, and it has given the broadening sense of political processes by the social media, by the technological aspects, that has a local, national, and global events constantly interact. This is really a very good aspect we are reading here, that global events constantly interact. Why? Because any event that has been occurred in any part of the world, easily interaction is there. Nothing is to be waiting, nothing is to be delaying process. Everything which is happening, we are getting in touch. So this is constantly interaction is there. So this is characteristics of globalization. What is happening there, that in accordance with in a relevance with a national state, we are going to cover here, that is geographical distance has less relevance. Significance of territorial boundaries has also less significance. Broadening of political process, there is a sense that not less, it has make the wide range. Political processes such that the local, national, and global events are constantly interacted. It means there is a some positive and some negative aspect can be seen, but we can say that when the changes and there is a revolution, we can say this is the technological revolution, this is a global revolution, and there is a requirement of a revolution after some timings. So this is the technological revolution by everybody is going and facing all of the aspect, that nobody is alone here. Forms of globalization. One is economic globalization. I am telling here that the globalization has many and many wide ranges in all of the zones that economic globalization can be counted in a global world. Cultural globalization, what is the role of cultural globalization? What is the role of political globalization? There is, we are covered here on the three. This is forms of globalization. That is economic globalization, cultural and political globalization. The term globalization encompasses a range of social, political, and economic change. There is very true words are here, that this, the term globalization refers to a range of social, political and economic change. There is 100% clear here. It expands and accelerates the exchange of ideas and commodities over vast distance. Yes. What happens here? There is a change of ideas and commodities upon the commodities over vast distance. Distance has no value now. It is common to discuss the phenomena in highly generalized terms, but globalization's impact are often best understood at the local level. It has become easy to discuss the phenomena in highly generalized terms. Yes. But globalization, if we think that what is nearby, so we can see and we can also notice that the impact are often best understood at local level. What is happening at the local level? We can say the term globalization has how much changed the local level lifestyle? Yes, there is a changes of lifestyle is there. There is a totally changes of lifestyle, because if you say that we can got easily the branded items, the branded products, our nearby showroom, nearby shops, nearby local, all of the areas. So it has become very easy. And we have not to think that the foreign countries, we have no any attention. We have not too much attention for the foreign countries' products. As usual, we are getting it our home door. So this is the effect, and this is the economic change we can see. Theories about the influence of globalization to nation states. There is all of the researchers, all of the theoretical thinkers, and the researchers has made the influence. They have make the research about that globalization influence has upon the nation state or not. This is here that hyper globalists argue. There is a group that has given the proper theories about that. Is there any influence of the globalization to nation state or not? That is, hyper globalist argues that the world had evolved these past years, and that is that it is now more borderless, as we have covered before. This is hyper globalist is saying here that the society has become more borderless, especially in the economic field. National economies are now part of a global economy. As you have seen that our product has got value in a global market. We can use our brain and our ideology for making the ideology of global ideology. So this is, national economies are now part of the global economy, where international financial markets and transnational dominate. They say there is a denationalization, but that is a part of economic logic in which national governments are just transmission belt for global capital. This is here that hyper globalist, what they want to say, that national economies are now part of a global economy, where international financial markets and transnational dominate. They say that there is a denationalization, but that is a part of economic logic in which governments are just transmission in a global capital. So hyper globalist has evolved these past years that is more now more borderless, especially in the economic field. We are in a time of borderless economy and where the state is territorially limited. We are here that in a time of borderless economy and where the state is territorially limited. Global markets are free to escape political regulations. Hyper-globalists see the globalization as a good thing, which would give opportunities to societies to develop. Here's to be seen that time of borderless economy. Yes, there is a way, there is a scene to be noticed here that borderless economy is to be seen in a global way and where the state is territorially limited. But we can say the state has a limited territory. But after that, they have a global market and free to escape political regulations. This is here that they can, in an economic term, we can say they have a global market and they have a they are free to escape political. They doesn't have the political regulation accordingly to the nation state. But if we say that if the nation is going to strong in an economic way, but there is also to be kept to be knowledge that a state is also making their strength in a economic world. And political regulations, they are also following, but they are making their economy strong also. That means which state, any type of state has many type of resources. So all of these resources is counted not in a term of national term, but it should be counted in a state term, in limited territorial limited term also. So we can say that this is the scenario of borderless economy, but state has got the value of just like a nation because there is a global market are free to escape political regulation there. And one thing is there that hyper-globalists see the globalization as a good thing, which would give the opportunities to society to develop. There is a thing that what the hyper-globalists want to say, what they want to say that this is the thing that the society has to develop accordingly to what they are getting the opportunities. And there is many and many opportunities they can go further and they can make their positivity in a progressive scenario. So there is hyper-globalist want to say that the borderless economy, which is fruitful to all of the state because they have the markets and they are free to escape political regulation as according to in terms of nation state. So there is a hyper-globalist also, they want to say that this is a good thing and that phenomena can give the opportunities to the societies to make a progress aspect. In contrast, skeptics disagree. There is also a group that also make a research and that has become the theories about the globalization, the effect of globalization upon the nation state. What they want to say that in contrast, the hyper-globalist, the skeptics disagree with this thesis. They are not agree about the hyper-globalist views and theories. They say that the world has not evolved much and that instead of being in a globalized world, we are now in a more international world. They are saying the same, but there is a wording can be changed here that world has not evolved too much. They are going to start with this sentence that the world has not evolved too much. Instead of being in a globalized world, we are now in a more international world. They want to say that we have entered in an international world. They are not agree with all these things, all these thesis that the world has become the global. they have changed a new term, that is they are interested to introduce the society and the state in a more international world. First, Hurst and Thompson argued, there is a researcher, there is a theoretical persons there, Hurst and Thompson argued that various tendencies towards internationalization can be accommodated within a modified view of the world economic system that still gives the major role to national level policies and economic actors. When firms, government and international agencies are being forced to behave differentially, but in the main they can use existing institutions and practices to do so. This is the skeptics disagree, and they have given that any type of tendencies towards internationalization can be accommodated with a modified view of the world economic system. They think about that there should be internationalization, and with the world economy is going to adopt in a modified view. That still gives the major role to national level policies. This is also that national level policies and economic actors, that is industrialists and all the firms and entrepreneurs and the government and international agencies, they have to behave differentially. But if we say that existing institution and practicing, they are doing the same. So there is a skeptics who have a negative sense about this, that the globalization has given a negative effect upon the nation state. And for the skeptics, the state remains central in the business activities, and even that is the most powerful actor in domestic economy and in international agreement and regulations. What is here that the skeptics, they are also want to say there, because they are not in the favor of that the global world has become, they are thinking that state has come in an international level. This is the main line here, that the skeptics remains central in the business activities, always it has remained, and even that is the most powerful actor in domestic economy and also in international agreement and regulations also. As they want to say that the domestic economy and the in agreement and regulations, they are also favoring and they are also obeying in before of the terms before the globalization. But what they want to say, the multinational corporation having headquarter in different countries can be described as national companies operating internationally and thus subject to the national regulations. They have a different view about that the MNCs is also welcomed in the countries. As usual, they are operating internationally and thus subject to the national regulations. Moreover, the state has still a crucial role in the scheme of governments and regulations, and through elections it remains the critical agencies of the popular representation. And to conclude, the state that the world is now divided into larger regional area rather than into one world. They are in a terms that they conclude, they want to confirm that the state in the world is now divided into larger regional area. They doesn't want to confirm about that, rather that into a world. They are not covering that the world is now divided into a larger regional area. They are not happy with the saying that into one world. Their statement is just like that. However, we can say that transformationalists take a middle ground approach between the two previous extreme views of globalization. There is a hyper globalist also we have read here, And the skeptics also we have read here. We have given the approaches. We have given attention to the approaches of skeptics and the hyper globalist. There is in a middle ground approach. There is also a middle ground approach can be seen here. That is the transformationalist. They have taken a middle ground approach between the two previous extreme views of globalization. What they want to? They argue that globalization is a multi-scalar process and do not believe in a single global society. Because of the hyper-globalist and skeptics has a very negative form. Between this, they have the transformationalist taken a middle ground approach. They want that, they express that, that the two previous extreme views of globalization has given their views about the effectiveness, but they have no properly given the theories about the globalization that should be suited to all of the communities. So they given a new approach about that the globalization is a multi-scalar process. There is a multi-scalar, not a one and two scalar. There is a multi-scalar process and do not believe in a single global society. They want to say that they believe in a single global society. The current global interconnections and interdependence will forge new networks and maybe dissolve some existing ones. They are expressing that the current global interconnections and interdependence, what will happening in the global interconnection and interdependence, because no any country is to be firm about that. They have no any interaction with all of the countries. They have got this idea, they have got this lesson that every country has a interdependency each other. So will forge new networks. What will happen? Interconnections, interdependencies will make a new networks and maybe dissolve some existing ones. If any issues can be created by any country, so these type of networks can solve new existing problems. As held say, relationship among nations and people will be reconfigured and power relationship restructured. It will not be the end of nation state, more a reconstruction of a nation state. Yes. Held also said about that the relationship among nations and people will be reconfigured and power relationship reconstructed. They believe that a new society, new relationship and a newly interdependency and we can say networks is going to be reconstructed, restructured. So there should be a new reconstruction, we can say. There should be a new ideology and new technology restructured. And there remain a very interconnectivity as according to global platform. This reconstruction will remain more fruitful to all of the states. So this is the transformationalist has given the new middle ground approach. This is they want to say that they want to express about the globalization that this is a multi-scalar process and this they doesn't believe in a single global society. The current global interconnections and interdependencies will make a new networks and this will be helpful for making the existing struggles, existing challenges, they can dissolve them. As according to Held, that he want to say that relationship among nations and people will be reconfigured and power relationship restructured. There is a new thing is to be covered here by the transformationalist, that it will not be the end of the nation state. What they want to say? It will be a new start, more a reconstruction of the nation state. It will be worked here. So, as usual, we have covered here the transformationalist, hyper-globalist and skeptics also we have covered. These are the three theories that has been given according to the globalization, including the nation state, as there is a effect on effective way they are going to give in accordingly to the globalization. As students, these are the theories about the influence of globalization to the state. We are now giving the repetition of these, all of the topic. That is, we have given the term definition of globalization, that is, globalization impacts are often best understood at the local level. We have given here forms of globalization, that is economic, cultural and political, also covered here. Characteristics of globalization, here is to be that what is the main features of globalization, that is what they are want to say, that declining relevance of geographical distances, lessening significance of territorial boundaries, and global events constantly interact, deepening and broadening of political process such that the local, national and global level. What is the main word of globalization? That is the process through which societies have become so intertwined or interconnected that events and decisions in one part of the world have significant effects on the lives of people in the part of the world. We have given the Aristotle six type of government, that is one who governs and how many governs. There is, if one person governs, that is monarchy. If a few person govern, that is aristocracy, and many persons, that is polity. And a negative form we have also covered here, that is tyranny, oligarchy and democracy. There is three types, negative forms: tyranny, oligarchy and democracy. Government, what is the meaning of government? I have given here, is the machinery of the state through which the will of the people is formulated and carried out. This is the government main keywords, we can say. This is the machinery of a state, that because every type of state has a government, and this government is counted here, government is noticed here to work as a machinery of the state through which the will of the people is formulated and carried out. We are saying about that types of a state. There is three type I have given here: effective, weak and failed. That state has a effective role if that state is going to work accordingly, that state controls taxes and entire territories, laws are mostly obeyed there, the state provides general welfare and welfare and security, and there should be treated minor corruption. So that state should be counted as a effective state. Weak, where there is a lawlessness, corruption, poverty and the governmental revenues go to the private pockets, that is treated as a weak. And failed, if there is a national government is not there and the state is ruled by army and militants, and education and law is not there, that should be counted as a failed. Four elements of state we have given here, that is sovereignty, government, territorial and territory and people. So all of the things that has been covered here, that is state, nation and globalization. That is all of the terms we have given about the globalization, about the state and about the nation also. I have given five features of the state, that is, it is sovereign, its institutions are public, it is an instrument of domination. It is a territorial association. This is here. Four elements of the state. My dear student, I think you have got all of the things accordingly. And this is a very important topic which has covered today. Now the timings is all going to over. So this is globalization and nation state. We have covered here. Thanking you very much. This is state, nation and globalization. Thanking you.